Welcome to the webinar, Food Security for the World, on behalf of the farewell of Ruurt Rubben and Krijn Poppe from Wageningen University and Research, but more in particular from Wageningen Economic Research. So welcome Ruurt and Krijn. What we're going to do up here is for you, you know, that's what this is all about, and also the sessions that we're going to have tomorrow and the day after. My name is Jacques van der Vorst. I'm the General Director of the Social Sciences Group at Wageningen University and Research. I will be chairing this session today. And this session focuses on the major challenges that the global food system faces in terms of food insecurity, the triple burden of malnutrition, as you all know, the relation to hunger, micronutrient deficiencies, overweight, obesity, and the rising vulnerability to health and environmental problems. It focuses on the growing importance of global food system transformation, and attention will be given to the potential of poverty alleviation programs and the contribution of nutrition-sensitive value chains for reaching healthier diets and more inclusive food systems. And this supports the critical role of the social sciences research for bridging the insights between production systems innovation, incentives for improving consumption behavior, and scaling strategies through multi-stakeholder food system governances. We are very pleased to have two renowned speakers, Mr. Johan Svinne and Mrs. Marijke Kuiper. And we look forward to her presentations, so a special welcome to them. And we will also afterwards have two discussants, Maximo Torero and Paul van der Locht. I will introduce them later, more in particular, to have, let's say, a discussion on the topics that were discussed. And of course, finally, the word today will be given to Ruurt Rubben in the last 5 minutes to give a reflection upon what happened. In the session tomorrow, Krijn will have the opportunity to pick that up. While the presentations are being given, we also have the opportunity, the potential to give some questions and to post them in the chat. I will try to keep an eye on that and see if we can have a nice discussion afterwards. Our first speaker, Mr. Johan Svinne, but as you see in the name on the video, Jo Svinne for the intermediate. Mr. Svinne became Director General of the International Food Policy Research Institute only in January 2020. Quite an interesting start given the COVID situation, of course, in the last months, Jo. Prior to joining IFPRI, Jo was Professor of Economics and Director of the Lycos Center for Institutions and Economic Performance at Leuven University in Belgium and Senior Research Fellow at the Center for European Policy Studies in Brussels. And I think we can say over the course of his career, Jo was a visiting professor at various universities, but also a frequent advisor to all kinds of institutions like the World Bank, European Bank for Reconstruction Development, Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, FAO, etc. And working still closely with Ruurt for many years already, but also in the last year. And that's why we're very glad that you're here to give a presentation. The floor is yours, Mr. Svinne.
Dankjewel, Jack. Het is een grote eer voor mij om hier te zijn vandaag. It's a great honor for me to be here and to participate in the special event to celebrate the very rich careers of Ruurt Rubben and Krijn Poppe. I have known both for a long time and I've collaborated in various capacities with both Ruurt and Krijn. And so it's a great pleasure for me to talk at this event. Somehow I feel like, although it's an event to celebrate the kind of the end of a bit of their career, it feels more that geen vaarwel, maar tot weerziens. It seems like a better prediction of reality or of the future, let me say. So what I'll do, starting off, I'm going to briefly summarize a couple of key points I would like to make, and then I'm going to use a number of slides to go through them. I just want to make sure that these come across over. First, so the current food system as it exists today is off track for reducing hunger and malnutrition in the foreseeable future. And this was already the case before COVID-19. COVID-19 is reinforcing these problems and these challenges. But at the same time, COVID-19 provides a great opportunity, I think, for making radical and transformative changes. Changes which perhaps otherwise would not have been possible. So it makes changes in... These changes have to be in how we produce food, in how we link food production to consumption, in what we consume. And these are major changes that are required in terms of both for the private sector and for the public sector. in terms of things such as technology, organization of society, industrial organization, public policy, our subsidy systems, our public investments. And these changes should be targeted to make our food system more sustainable, more inclusive, so that also the poor can benefit from it and more resilient going forward. So let me now go to the slides. Let me see. I don't see my slides.
Slides are somewhere in between the small people, and you should pin it to your, if you put the right mouse button on the little dots, you can pin the presentations, and then it will be visible for everybody. Or for you, at least.
Yeah, I can see them in the small thing. It's okay, because I know them, of course. Can we go one slide back, please? Yeah. So the food system, as we know it today, is pressing planetary boundaries. It is pressing planetary boundaries because it's using more than 30% of the global energy and more than 20% of global greenhouse gas emissions. It's also contributing to increased water stress and scarcity, affecting production in large parts of the world, and particularly in the poorest parts of the world. Next slide, please. Despite this pressure on our planetary boundaries, the healthy diets are out of reach for many of us. Next slide, please. More than 3 billion people worldwide cannot afford a healthy diet, as it's been identified by a set of researchers and specialists in, for example, the Eat Lancet diet that we know. Okay. But in addition to that, okay, it's not only a healthy diet, which is out of reach for billions of people, also hunger is on the rise again. Next slide, please. This slide shows how hunger and malnutrition have really improved significantly, have fallen very strongly in the 2000s up to essentially 2014, roughly. And since then, we've seen a turnaround. So these are data from FAO. I'm sure Maximo knows them very well. And so since then, there has been a flattening out of the curve, and there is a rise of the curve in recent years and predicted to go further again. What is the cause of that? Next slide, please. One reason for this is essentially economic growth, or if I say the lack of economic growth. So here you see the evolution of economic growth for middle-income countries and for Africa. And so particularly the numbers for Africa, which were very significant, positive for almost two decades, have now turned negative. And this has had a very significant impact on food security, or food insecurity, to be more precise. Next slide, please. Another reason is conflict. There's always been conflict in the world, but conflicts in the world have really rapidly picked up the last 5 years. And this is illustrated by this in this graph, the right-hand side of the graph, which shows the number of forcibly replaced people worldwide. And that has gone up tremendously. And this, of course, is to some extent related to climate change. Next slide, please. The location of these conflicts. So on the left-hand panel here, you see that, again, it is very much in poor countries of the world that there have been significant displaced people, both internally and externally, it means across borders. And so in 2019, there were about almost 80 million people forcibly displaced, and 80% of these were in countries affected by acute food insecurity and malnutrition. Next slide. And the link, or at least the correlation with climate change, is clear from this picture here. You see on the right-hand panel that the average temperature, or the deviation from normal temperatures, has picked up very significantly also in the last 5 years of this period. So we are really seeing a big change that has happened since 2014, since 2015. It's not only hunger that is on the rise, but also malnutrition, or the double burden of malnutrition, if you want. Next slide, please. So here we illustrate, so the double burden of malnutrition is where the same countries, the same societies are confronted with not enough food, and at the same time not eating the right food, which is typically captured by obesity, growth, etc. What we see is that the correlation in developing countries between income classes, income categories, and obesity is, or let's say on the malnutrition, not enough food, that's clearly, it's obviously that the richest groups in society have less of a problem with it than the poorest part of society. In terms of obesity, it's the other way around. In developing countries, it is the higher income classes where the number of obese people are higher than in the poorer categories of society. Next slide. What's interesting, if you look at this across countries, and there you see that these are data from two African countries on the left, two middle income countries in the middle, and through higher income European countries on the right. And you see that this correlation changes over time as well. So in terms of obesity, it's concentrated in the richer categories in developing countries. It's roughly the same across different income groups in rich countries, in middle income countries, and then it's declining with income in higher income countries. Okay, next slide, please. So the, do I have to do something on the video on the of my presentation, or can I just continue?
You can just continue, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Right, so how has COVID added to that? Well, COVID has added to that in the sense that it has increased the poverty. So this is predictions from IFPRI in terms of, we estimate that roughly 150 million people may fall into acute food security problems, extreme poverty. At the same time, we see a big shift from more nutritious food to less nutritious food, as economic models would predict this. Next slide. Our estimates now from country studies, there we see we have estimated that what the impacts are on GDP and on poverty, and these impacts are large. So these are effects estimated per average per month of lockdown in Indonesia, Ghana, and Nigeria. And you see, for example, increases in poverty percentage points are between 10 and 16%, which are really large effects. And that is because the poorest people are disproportionately affected by COVID-19 for a number of reasons. Next slide, please. The poorest people are disproportionately affected, for example, because they spend, of course, a larger share of their incomes on food. Their main production factor is physical labor, so they have to go out and work in the fields or in the factories or whatever. They don't have a lot of skilled human capital. They can't work with Zoom or write emails all the day, so they have to go out and work. And they are most susceptible to being affected by the virus itself, but also by the most strongly affected by the lockdown restrictions. In addition, typically, because value chains in developing countries are typically more labor intensive, and also social programs, nutrition programs from the public sector side are more targeted to the poor people, and these are disrupted as well. They have less access to health services, and typically what we see is children, women, and former migrants, okay, are mostly affected. Next slide. So while these are conceptual predictions and some model predict, these are data from recent data coming in from survey analyses, in this case from Ethiopia, and they largely confirm what we had predicted. So we see there that it's the poorest people in society who suffer more from income losses, and it's the poor people who suffer more from nutrition, from basically worsening nutrition in terms of access to more nutritious food. Next slide. So on the next slide, I have listed a number of reasons why women are especially vulnerable for COVID-19, both in terms of for the impacts in the short run and also in the long run. It matters there because it affects schooling probably, and this schooling we know is a very important indicator for long-term basically empowerment of women and also access to better jobs. And so therefore, a series of blogs by IFPRI Research on our website have recommended that public policy programs, support programs should really be gender sensitive to compensate for these gender effects. On the next slide, we have some recent results coming out of work in Myanmar. And there we find clearly that the impact from, and these are declines from remittances, which are really important in Myanmar for the poorest people. You see the urban effects, the rural effect in general, -11.8%, are roughly double the size in terms of income loss for the household as those in urban areas. And the rural female-headed households are affected three times as much in this region. So a very strong gender effect on that as well. We then look at the food systems. Next slide. There we see that the farming itself is actually relatively less affected. I mean, it's still, the numbers are still large. The numbers that we have here from Nigeria and Myanmar are around 15%, so 50% decline is big, so I don't want to minimize this, but it's relatively less than the processing sector of the food system, and particularly the service sector or service part of the food system, okay? And this is true in general as well if we compare the agri-food system with industry and with particularly the service sector in the economy, it's the service sector which is mostly affected. Next slide. So that means also if we think about building back better, the restructuring of the supply chains and the food systems, what we observe there is, I think, two things. One is there's a large heterogeneity in these food systems and to the supply chains, and that means they're also differently affected. And we have to draw lessons on that, I think, from thinking about the future. What are the food systems, supply chains, which have been most resilient in the current situation, and what are the changes that are needed to made to be made to make them resilient, sustainable, inclusive, etc. going forward. What we see already is that there's a lot of innovation going on in these supply chains, right, over the past couple of months, both in the private sector, and then we're talking both on, let's say, the large food processing and food trading companies, but also at the low, at the level of SMEs and micro enterprises, etc. One thing that we see is that a rapid growth of digital, of the digital economy and the agri-food system, not just in rich countries or middle-income countries, but also in developing countries. Next slide. Here we have some interesting recent new data coming in from our work in Myanmar. And so people were asked basically, how have you been mostly affected by COVID-19? And what's interesting on the food security side is that the big effect is really on the demand side. It's the income effect, which are much more important than the supply side effect. And despite the disruptions, the food supply chains or the food supply systems have reorganized themselves relatively well compared to the demand side. And I think that's important going forward. Let me then end with a couple of points on policies. One is on next slide. We've seen a rapid growth actually, and this is a very positive sign, I think, on social protection systems. This slide kind of just summarizes some of the data which the World Bank has been collecting, and I think FAO as well, on the growth of these, of the scaling up and the sustaining and extra investment in social protection system, I think is really important. Next slide, another area is trade, obviously, and this links with our global supply chains as well. Trade is obviously crucial for food security, but also for dealing with climate change and the interaction between both. But several of the policies have not made it easier. Next slide. So the next slide is a summary of the locking down of borders inside Africa. And you see that within a month in March, I mean, there was a rapid growth in the lockdown or the closing of the borders within Africa. And we know that initially there was a lot of export restriction by global food exporters that we have observed. And luckily, and I think in reaction to statements by FAO, by IFPRI, by the World Bank, the G20, etc., export restrictions have been removed over the past month, I think, which again is an interesting and important development. The next slide talks about the link between trade protection and agricultural support programs and climate change. Okay, and what we see there, this is really interesting work, which we are doing together with OECD and the World Bank. And there we actually find that the externalities of our current agricultural subsidy system, this is a bit less for Europe than for the rest of the developing countries, is that it's actually concentrated in what we call emission intensive commodities. That means that commodities which have relatively high greenhouse gas emissions are basically getting the highest level of support. And this is something we have to change for the future, I think. The next slide, this is the last one on the policy, is that essentially this is the results from a study which was just done. IFPRI collaborated on that. And maybe Maximo will talk about it as well, because FAO played an important role here as well. And there essentially a study was done, how much investment and what type of investment is needed from the donors and from the countries themselves to reduce end hunger sustainably by 2030. And the study essentially comes to the conclusion that we need to double our assistance. Well, the current assistance is roughly $12 billion. And so they say we need to double that and focusing and through the entire food system. So making it more inclusive, investing in new technologies, better technologies, and also on the system as a whole. I can come back to details on that if you like. And so to end in the next slide, I just summarize again the point I made at the beginning. I think what we are in this moment is really a transformative moment in history. And so a lot of creativity and innovation is going on right now in the supply chain. And so, or in the food systems as a whole. And so we have to move this, we have to see this as an opportunity for introducing changes, policy reforms, et cetera, to make those systems more resilient, more inclusive, and also more sustainable. And so again, there's a crucial role to play both for the private sector and the public sector. With that, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jo, for this nice presentation, emphasizing indeed the key changes that need to take place. We're holding back the discussion a little bit. If you have specific questions now on the presentation, please put them in the chat so we can bring them on later. I would now like to go to our second speaker, a direct colleague of Ruurt en Krijn, Marijke Kuipers, strategic senior scientist, international policy at Wageningen Economic Research. Like you say yourself, Marijke, a quantitative economist with 20 years of modeling experience, ranging from computable general equilibrium models at global and village level to micro simulation. So we go from the more generic view on what's happening in the world towards also a modeling view. You focus on food and nutrition security, poverty, inequality, bioeconomy, sustainability, etc. In other words, you focus on integrated assessments. And the key word that often comes back there is also the tool MAGNET that you've been working on together with all kinds of colleagues, and foremost also with Ruurt, for example, in the framework of the IFED Rural Development Report 2021. The floor is yours to give your views on the work you've done with Ruurt and especially the key points for you for this session.
Thanks, Jacques. And I think it's a nice, I have a nice a compliment to the work Josvinen just discussed. Can we get the presentation? Because I don't see it yet. Oh, there it is. Oh, you spoiled the... Can you go to the first one? You spoiled your surprise. Damn. That was meant as a surprise at the end. Well, Ruchi can prepare for
it. I didn't see it.
Good. Close your eyes. Wait for it. Okay. Tailoring to scale. Basically, what we've done... we're asked to reflect on the work we're doing at the Institute. We're linked to more the international perspective on food systems. And this was done with Gonne Beekman and Tom Achterbos. Next slide, please. What we looked at and what we actually want to reflect on, so it's more like an reflection on the work we're doing at the Institute, looking at food systems and why we're looking at food, because it links both human well-being. I mean, food is produced for people to give someone healthy, hopefully healthy life, but it also puts a lot of pressure on the environment, as Jo already indicated. So what I want to go through quickly in this presentation is some macro enablers and bottlenecks that we see mostly from the MAGNET related work. So that's global simulation work we've been doing over the past years. Then jump to some of the studies we've been doing at micro level, looking at triggers for lasting behavioral change. And at the last slide, we'll focus on the outline of the policy research agenda. So where we think there's really a gap in the work we're currently doing at the Institute, where we think we should could do more. Next slide, please. So global food for all. So basically the question, do we have enough food in the world? So next slide, please. And what is it? Next slide. So these are results from they're really hard to read anyway. These are results from the MAGNET model for five of the shared socioeconomic pathways. These are the long run projections up to 2100 that are used a lot in the climate studies. And basically what I did is I took some results we had laying around from a MAGNET study that's been published this year and looked at, is there enough food at the global level in terms of calories, in terms of staples, in terms of meat and eggs, and in terms of fruit and vegetables. The gray areas actually would be the place where there would not be enough. So I have like a one as an index, but that would be the optimum level. And I looked at the SOFI numbers. I also marked a bit of orange in the meat and eggs because that actually has a different scale than the other graphs. So it might be a bit misleading. Basically, there's way enough meat in the world. And for me, this really shows there is enough calories, there are enough cereals and meat. And this really is the result of a long lasting concerted effort to increase this and make sure there are enough calories, staples, and later on meat for the population. But the availability of food and vegetables is really a concern. And I think you can also see this in the setup of the CG institutes when there is no dedicated institute for food and vegetables. And given increasing awareness of healthy diets, I think the same concerted effort to increasing productivity for food and veg is needed as has been achieved actually for the other sectors. Next slide, please. But I'm an economist, so it's not only about production. a lot of talk when you see like global simulation studies is about prices. So what I plot in the upper graph is the change in the cost of a healthy diet over time, again, up to 2100 for the different SSP scenarios. And you see that the prices of a healthy diet are increasing over time. But as all economists know, it's not about prices, it's about prices relative to income. So the lower graph actually plots the price increases relative to the global increases in income. I took here GDP per capita. I also checked it for the wages of low skilled labor, which is basically indicative of the lower wages in the economy. And even there you see the same pattern. So we really see that there's enough food, prices will increase. There's definitely an issue with affordability of food, but I would really be a bit cautious in pushing now for lowering the price of food and veg as much as possible. It's of course the kind of easy solution because then you only have to focus on production, on supply chains, and not that it's easy to reach, but it doesn't basically force you to rest the question of distribution, because people that cannot afford a healthy diet basically have a lot of other issues as well. So just lowering the prices of food and veg and other healthy components of their diet is not going to solve the other issues they're having. Next to that, I would be really careful of starting a new race to the bottom that we've seen with a lot of the other agriculture production, where we're both taxing the limits of what farmers can actually bear and what the environment can bear. So I think that also we have to be very cautious where we want to steer this direction. And I think if we can do better in terms of reducing poverty and getting a more equal distribution, we also have more space to actually go for a production which is more costly, maybe to protect the environment, but also make it sure that people can still afford it. So I think we really should make inclusiveness and redistribution more than lip service. Next slide, please. Adding insult to injury, well, Joe already touched upon this, so I can go quickly. Both climate change and mitigation have large repercussions, especially in sub-Saharan Africa, where the number of undernourished are already increasing. So this really is a trade-off, or at least we need to do more. We cannot just only focus on the climate. We have to do something, again, on the distribution as well. As Jo already went through in much detail, the vulnerable regions are really hit hard by the global COVID-19 policy measures. So it's really adding insult to injury. The disasters really increase the inequality that are already there and make it even worse. Next slide, please. This slide was actually inspired by what I found an astonishing discussion over the summer on holidays linked to the COVID-19. There was a huge discussion in if the lockdowns would prevent people from going on holiday, which I thought that's an interesting thing to be very worried about in such circumstances. So I basically plotted this thing and it started me thinking on, we do a lot of global simulation projections where we basically what I say here, have a starry sky full of better global futures. So we're looking at all these trade-offs, and I think it's important work because you have to know when you set in for a long run development, you have to make sure as best as you can that you're not harming a wide set of objectives. The thing though is that we are not very clear how to get there. And I think what we're not really accounting for properly is loss aversion. There are a lot of people that lose something if we go and change something. Because if you look at the graph on the left, the dark red line in the bottom is global income distribution. That's actually the order of the population that I used. So basically it shows you that income is distributed very unequally. We all know that. And there was always this nice, comfortable story that if everybody gets richer, we don't really have to do anything about it, because then we can all, you know, stay rich, and then the poor will get less poor, and again by a diet. But as Joe already pointed out, hunger and poverty are increasing, so that didn't really pan out. But actually, from the other things I plotted, I think this is the easiest one in a sense to solve, because if you go then to the meat, that's the green line, it's a little bit less unequal than poverty than income. But here actually the incentives for change are a bit harder, because here we actually have to reduce the total amount of meat produced and consumed. And it basically means that the top part that's consuming a large part of the meat has to give something up. We have a story here on that it's good for your health, that in long run, it's a good idea to actually do this for your own interest. But we actually know from the literature that we scanned on the information and nudging and other incentives and prices that it's very hard to get that diet change there. And then people even have have an incentive. What I also plotted is the blue line, that's the greenhouse gas emissions linked to production from the World Development Indicators, and the orange line is what Oxfam just came out with, is the greenhouse gas emissions linked to consumption. And there you actually see from the consumption side that 20% of the population in the world actually is responsible for 50% of the greenhouse gas emissions linked to consumption. So people really need to change, and with greenhouses I think it's even a level up in terms of difficulty, because there is no reward in the short run. People that now have to give up their behavior, have to change something, do something like give up their holidays to Bali every year for a week, they don't get anything in return for themselves. And I think we're not addressing this. So really, I think the big challenge is how do we can we get the behavioral change at scale, where influential groups, I mean, people that have income, have power, actually have to give up something. And in a lot of cases, in settings where we have a four-year policymaking horizon, because these are democracies, people have to actually get the public approval again in 4 years, which makes it hard to enforce something that people don't want to lose. So I think loss aversion at scale is really something that we have to think about more carefully. So then turning to behavior, next slide, please. Now jumping more to the micro level of work that we're doing. Next slide, please. And I first want to pick up two examples. This is a big review of improvements in tropical commodities and tropical value chains. And basically it's a bit of a gloomy conclusion in that it didn't work. There were 50 years of interventions. The examples on the left are the cocoa yields, which have not really substantially increased anywhere. Real prices have gone down. So 50 years of work to lift these people, these farmers, improve their being, their well-being didn't really pan out. And basically what's happening is that people either do not adopt the new technologies or they do adopt and then disadopt later on. And when we were thinking about the discussion here or the focus here, it's really on this line of research really focuses on the context of people. So what is actually keeping them from adopting this optimal behavior? Next slide, please. This is another example of current ongoing work, actually just been done. And it was, I found it very intriguing because basically challenged the expectations both of the researchers and the participants. And they called it sometimes you only need to ask. So basically there was an experiment over this last summer in Lagos in Nigeria, where leafy green vegetables, which are very good for your health, were added to street food and people had to pay for it. So basically they had to pay extra and they would get extra fruit and veg with their common say dishes. And to everybody's surprise, almost 50% of the people actually accepted this. And it was a 10 to 25% price increase during COVID. So when there was a huge shock also to incomes. It could also be, of course, that COVID made people more aware of their health. But it was a big surprise both to the researchers and to the vendors that people were actually willing to do that if you would just ask them. There was the justification given for the price increase that it was good for the health. And the underlying reasoning from this was really from consumer research, that if you tell people, give them information that they are willing to change their behavior. So that was, I think, an interesting example from that. Next slide, please. And thinking through this a bit more, I'm thinking like when we look at production side, we tend to think of producers as very like single-minded objects, basically, that really just want to go for the maximum, say, profit, maximum income, or maximum production, depending a bit which context you come from. And we really focus on the contextual factors. So basically, it's like there are factors around them that hamper them from achieving this one single objective that they have. That's kind of the current thinking. You also see it in any of the quantitative modeling we do, that we always have a single profit function. But then we start working with consumer researchers, as I've been doing in the past couple of years. They have like the flip side of the coin. When you then go to consumers, they suddenly have this whole wide array of individual things and it becomes all individual. So it's really personal factors, it's taste, it's culture, everything really, really specific. And the price is only, and income is only one of the many, many drivers. So it's a very kind of, it's flipping in how we analyze these two things. And I think if we could combine those two, and we went through some examples, next slide, please. If you can combine this perspective, you can actually get new interventions and new approaches. So one thing was a study in Burundi, where they were trying to improve the diets. And eggs were just like the example, like eggs would really make it better in terms of diets, also for pregnant women. It actually turned out that they didn't want to do it. And it was basically kind of a context behavioral thing. They didn't want to produce it because they felt that diets of eggs were not for poor households. So poor households should not be eating eggs. It's like something for rich people. And because these producers were consumers as well, they would not produce them for themselves either. So that's kind of mind-boggling because you think it's an easy fix and it doesn't work. So if you don't think about these contextual factors also for production and these personal factors that are important, you might miss it. So another example from increasing fruit and veg, which is very difficult during normal, say, meals, because people have a very established idea of what meals are and how their meals should look like. And sometimes it's better to just avoid it. It's like just create new snack moments during the day where you eat fruit and veg so you don't have this burden from the past and you can actually increase it much easier. And there was one final example from Ruud, I guess apparently from a while back, but I thought it was really interesting, is you can use aspirational goods to stimulate production. So this was an example where they wanted to get a new production people didn't really want to adopt it. And then in the end, they started dancing. And I double checked with them. This was a dancing, as in music, going out, beers, all the stuff we're not allowed to do at the moment. But they actually created a means, or basically a desire for people to make more money to go to the dancing. And so they adopted the new production technology. So again, really thinking this through and combining these lines of work, I think can be a very important way to create the new instrument interventions that we need. Next slide, please. So basically we came up with this kind of tailored to scale summary. So we have to look at individual behavior. I mean, it's not one size fits all for everybody, but at the same time, it has to be at scale. I mean, we have to really change the food system and we have to do it fast. Next slide, please. So the tailored to scale, what we think, what we have to keep on doing is to quantify these trade-offs. So with this simulation modeling, it's very important to assess if you're not creating harm anywhere else in the system by focusing on one thing. So we have to definitely keep doing that. We also have to pay more attention to heterogeneity. We're doing more and more work. We've been doing this in the past. Look at the capabilities, opportunities, motivations of people and how you can intervene, look at distribution. I think we have to do more with experiments. I think at least in the institute, we have not been doing that so much, at least not widely across the institute. So we have these living labs where we try to experiment with things. And we might want to get involved in research implementation partnerships. We have a few of those where you actually test already during implementation if things are working or not working and steer. And of course, the holy grail that keeps coming back, I guess, every, I don't know, 10, 15 years, where we have to connect disciplines and skills. I mean, it's important. It's very hard work. I mean, everybody who's tried it, and I've been doing this for quite a while, it's definitely very hard. We're making, yeah, small steps. We have to keep doing that. So on the blue part, doing that has to continue. Very important work. But I think the one thing that we've been missing is really taking transformation serious. So really, when we have to have a food system, people lose something. And it's like with these holidays and COVID, it might be ridiculous, but it is something you have to take into account and think about when you set up your interventions. So I think we have to be more creative, that we have interventions that are in the long run for the common good, but you have to work around loss aversion, that people lose something in what they like. We have to take into account better, I think, political realities, study those, and we basically have to work out a way to make a food system change and really at scale in the short run, because these issues are really pressing. And this should not be a standalone thing, I think, as this thing, because I know there's a lot of work being going on there, but it's always kind of a separate line of work from all the other, say, work we're doing. And I think it has to be an integral part. So then we come to the last, which was supposed to be the surprise slide. Next slide, please. We were told not to do anything personal and make this a thing for Ruud Klein, but I'm not well known for listening to instructions. So I think I'll stick to that. So Ruud, I really want to thank you for all your never-ending ideas and energy to make a difference. And I thought it was like a really fitting picture. It's actually from my first business trip before I was a PhD student in 1997. I was on a 2-week trip with Ruud and Nico Hering through China. We're waiting here at the train station for our next stop. And I think it would be, it was the start of my career in a sense. I think it would be nice to have that in this presentation to honor Ruud's at least steps within the institute. So I'll leave it at that.
Thanks, Marijke. And as always, we know you like this indeed. Also for creativity, as you just said, should also come back in the presentation. Although you look quite different, as well as Ruud I saw on the picture. I see a lot of questions already coming in the chat. And I also see the time passing. So I would like to go on now. Thank you very much, Marijke, for your contribution. I think a clear statement on a few issues regarding modeling and how to change the system in the future. I would like to go to the discussants. We have two highly respected colleagues who are going to reflect upon what has been presented. I know it's challenging. We have 5 minutes for each and then some discussion. But as you know, we have a session tomorrow and Wednesday as well. And maybe also there, some of the questions can still be picked up by Ruud and Krijn. The first one, Maximo Torero, the chief economist of the Food and Agriculture Organization, FAO, joined the organization January 2019 as Assistant Director General for the Economic and Social Development Department. And prior to that, World Bank Group Executive Director for Argentina, Bolivia, Chile, Paraguay, Peru, and Uruguay, a whole list. And you led the division of the markets, trade, and institutions at IFPRI before that. Your more major research work lies in analyzing poverty, inequality, and in policies oriented towards poverty alleviation. While this links, of course, very much to the presentation that were just given, And Ruud really appreciates the collaboration of the last year. So we look forward to the questions that you have for the discussions. So maybe you can give a reflection, Maximo. The floor is yours.
No, thank you very much. And it's an honor to be here to honor Ruud and Graham Popper. And with Ruud, I have a long relationship also because of the linkages to my home country, Peru. So a pleasure to be here. So let me bring some ideas in the 5 minutes I have. They told me 15, so now it's 5. That's okay. I can adjust. So in any case, so first, I think the situation before COVID-19, as Joe mentioned, was already very dramatic. No, 600 million people undernourished, 2 billion people that didn't have regular food, and 3 billion people that didn't have access to healthy diets. I think the point mentioned by Malika in terms of the solution of healthy diets. So in the staple world, we know that we have enough staples today, despite of COVID-19, even the supply is good. Although there are some caveats there, we need to look at it carefully, but the supply is there. On high value commodities, the story is different, no? But it's linked to many things. And it's not only saying to the producers, produce more, because that is not easy, as Ruud perfectly knows. It has a lot of food safety issues. And many things behind, and it's not only changing the behavior of consumers. There are several things that we need to look at it, and I will try to touch some of them. But also conflict, climate, slowdowns and downturns were already there and are still there. And those are bigger problems, no? Climate is not only extreme temperatures and excessive water or little water, it's also volatility, no? What I call the variance, the second moment, which is basically for me what really is the most complicated thing to assess in terms of climate, because people say irrigation will resolve the problem, but relative to non-irrigated areas, areas that will have water because of climate change now will be better off than the irrigated areas. So in terms of changes, the way we look in economics, the situation could be very different to what we expect. So again, the variability is what worries and what is complex. And then we have now the COVID-19, which is a kind of a surprise. No, it's not only the error that we expect, but this is this mu that we never thought that it was going to happen, and it's coming up and it's changing the life of everybody. And basically what it's doing is in a choke, it's moving us out of the reduction of extreme poverty we have. We are moving no more than 10 years backwards. It's completely moving out of the potential capacity to achieve SDG 2, SDG 1, but especially it's increasing inequalities. That's something that you mentioned in your graph, and inequalities, because there are going to be substantial trade-offs on the decisions being made by governments to reactivate economies and so on. Even in the decisions of the lockdowns, there are already enormous trade-offs that the less advantaged ones are going to be affected. So this significant consequence of inequality, which not too many people are talking about and which you mentioned both, I think for me is one of the major structural problems, because honestly, there is very little evidence on policies to reduce inequality. It's because politically difficult, because of tax reforms, of course, and so on and so forward, because of land reforms, also land inequality issues. But when I was in the bank, we were trying to look at solid evidence, and we couldn't find too much of what were a package of policies to reduce inequalities, which is something I think extremely important to look at it. Now, what I was concerned about the staple world, yes, its reserves are growing and we have more stocks than we have in 2007, 2008. But if you look at the composition between China and non-China, most of the growth is because of China. And most of the spikes we are observing in the last month on prices is because of China. And whatever China does now in terms of their policy of procurement and replacement of stocks, even not only on the cereals, but also on feedstock, indirectly through what they have to purchase on pork meat because of the problem they had with the African swine fever, is affecting enormously markets. Now, during COVID-19, it's great for the key exporters of staplers because it's giving them prices that they were not expecting. We were expecting prices to go down because of the recession. So in certain way, this control of the demand by one country is benefiting Argentina, Brazil, and the US because it's allowing them to sell at higher prices, which we were not expecting. So again, it's interesting to look at the dynamics, but it also tells us how vulnerable we could be and what we need to be careful to do that. Now, the way we are seeing the potential change for us is basically we have what we call 4 accelerators. So 3 that move very fast or could move very fast, which is data, big data, technology, and innovation. So those 3, if they are done properly, they can move fast. But if we are not careful, they could create less competition, they could create a lot of problems. And there is where we need to build up governance, institutions, and human capital. No? Those are what I call the fourth accelerator, is one that could slow the process, but could help the process to be done properly. Now, why is this so important? Because it is true, as Joe mentioned, that with doubling the investment of developed countries in aid, $14 billion annually until 2030, could move 500 million people out of poverty. This is only if this catalytic investment is done in cooperation with investment of the countries and is done in catalytic investments. So it's not resolving the cash transfers and so on that already are happening. It's ceteris paribus. If I bring from heaven $15 billion more or $14 billion more per annum, in addition to $14 billion from the countries, that will create the change that we're looking at. But again, it's very specific, the investments that you have to do, and that is difficult. It's not easy. No, it's very difficult to accomplish R&D returns, extension services, digital agriculture, small irrigation, female literacy, and also improving the social protection system. So that could happen, but again, it's giving us an option. We can do it if we do it properly, and we need to change many ways in which we operate. But the major problem for me is the issue of resilience, because the way I'm seeing, and I think both of you mentioned this, is how we are going to handle this sector with this uncertainty, because we will have huge uncertainty, and what we can do to handle this huge uncertainty. And a resilient food system is one that minimizes in advance risks, so basically vulnerabilities in advance, but is also able to couple with the risk or the surprises that may occur. And that's the capability. So I need to have the balance of both predictive power, but also being able to couple. And there I think it's important to combine old and new things. I completely agree with Joe. We have to be imaginative and find new ideas, and also with Marike in the behavioral part and looking at behavioral part and the change that I need to do. But I also think that there are very things that we should do and for which we can bring technology data. The first thing is trade. So trade, both global but also intra-regional trade, is an option, and we are not exploiting that. And we are not exploiting that because of tariffs on one side, but when even the tariffs are being resolved, like in the Africa Free Trade Agreement, it's a problem of non-tariff barriers, which are mostly linked to food safety issues. And that is mostly information to standards and to the institutions part that I was referring. So that's an option. But again, that could help also the supply and demand issue of the healthy diets, because by moving commodities better, you can reallocate better from countries that are in excess eating meat, like the US or Europe, with countries which are not eating in excess meat, Africa and some parts of Asia. So again, it will allow us to better align and allocate the resources. So it's an option that we need to think carefully, and we need to find ways in which we can use this data, technology, and innovation to accelerate this process. The second one is infrastructure. And we don't talk too much again about infrastructure. The bank got very afraid of infrastructure because of the safeguards. And they run away from it now. And they talk about human capital, they move to other types of infrastructure. And I think it's a mistake. Infrastructure is important, it's central. If we don't have infrastructure, we won't be able to do things. So, and I think it's linked to health, it's linked to agriculture, it's linked to everything. So I think we need to start thinking again of that, but doing it differently. The problem with infrastructure is that when we invest in infrastructure, we go to the history, ports, mining, and we rebuild what is there. And we don't think differently on where to put infrastructure that will link markets, especially in agriculture. And I think that's really important. Now, on the other side, the trade-off is that if you are more connected, you are more sensitive to shocks. So we need to be careful on how to handle that and what mechanisms we need to put in place. And the third one is the use of technology wisely. You know? So yes, you can create efficiency gains, but we shouldn't forget technologies. We are obsessed with digital technologies, and digital technologies is the panacea of the world. Now, we have reviewed the literature on digital technologies, and there are a lot of problems behind it. And cellular phones are very expensive. There could be options to cellular phones which are cheaper. But again, what happens if there is no energy tomorrow because of something? The cellulars won't work. Nothing will work. So what do we do? No more digital technologies. So again, the important thing of digital technologies is that they are cost effective. It's a cost effective way to diffuse information. But the content is what really matters, and the capability of using that content. So if I don't have electricity, I should do the traditional way, but I need to have good content. That's the only way I can create a change. So again, we need to be ready to these weird situations where energy could be off tomorrow. And then we are in a big situation. Right now, everybody's okay because they can link through Zoom and do all these things that we are doing, but because the shock was only a health shock. But what happened if it was an energy shock? Okay.
Maximo, can I invite you to come to a concluding statement?
Just to finish. So the only thing I want to say is resilience is important, and we need to find ways to do that, and it's not an easy job, and it's a huge challenge, and I think Ruber has done a lot of work on this, and so thank you very much. It was a pleasure to commend both of you. Thank you.
Thank you for this contribution, Maximo. Yeah, sorry, we have to go on because we have another discussant, and we do want to give Ruud also the floor, and time is going quickly. Paul van der Locht, our next discussant, head of the Food and Nutrition Security Team at the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs, focusing on the reduction of the number of people in the situation of malnutrition and improve smallholders' productivity and promote sustainable management of farmland. Paul, I think from a governmental perspective, you probably also have some nice statements to make. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the presentations. To start with the role that Ruud has played in our policy, I think like Ruud, of course, was part of the ministry. So every time we talked to him, it felt like we were talking to a colleague. So it was very hard to distinguish when we were talking to Wageningen or to one of our own. And I think that has worked really well. And he has had a very big influence on what we're trying to do. Anecdotal, I had a talk with somebody for a job interview, and he said, like, well, the way you present like where you're going with food security, you're already sort of done with thinking about where it needs to go. And I said, like, no. Like food security is never done. It's not a sort of one dot at the horizon where we need to go. And that's the point I wanted to echo. I think like both what Jo said about historic transformation that we're witnessing, or hopefully witnessing, and the cross-disciplinary point that Marijke made. I think like if we're successful in the Food System Summit, we managed to sort of get these trends together. So one is the system thinking. And I mean, if I listen to Maximo is still trying to sort of like figure out like, oh, this is the one that you need to do, or this is what you need to do. And that there's never going to be sort of one thing. And that's also what Maximo was saying, right? So like, it's not digital, it's not just diets, it's not just agriculture. But it's that system awareness where that is increasing and could be very transformative in how we approach food security. Then there's the modeling of to test the system and to see what works. But then, and I think that's what needs to happen this year, is then what are the key synergies and trade-offs that we can actually act upon? Because of course, like the science like, can be used as an excuse to keep studying and not do anything, but this is really the time for big changes in the way we feed people. And I think that, and the good thing about what's happening now, that this is not an issue just of developing countries, but also of the developed world. Like the outcomes of the system are not well-being of people. So that needs to change. And I think there are some very clear trade-offs, and there's some very clear synergies that can be pointed out and put on the agenda of the summit, where that can then, and then hopefully the food system dialogues that now have been announced can be translated to the national level, because the dice won't change from a developing project, but will have to change like, sort of in country and match and production needs to fit that. And I hope that will have a translation to the national level, but will also get some sort of institutions or agenda similar to climate change, where we get people together that feel that they're jointly responsible for that part of the system, so that they feel comfortable working together and not compete over solutions and be able to set clear targets. I'm really confident that will happen. And I really see that the more central position that nutrition has and diets have and markets have as one of the things that Ruud has advocated always in commenting on our policies, and which is also very much something that we would like to now see internationally and have good faith that will happen. And hopefully Wageningen will stay on board with us and keep helping us to play that role that we want to play in that discussion. So thank you very much.
So Sorry. Thank you, Paul, for this elaboration. And of course, Ruurt is leaving us at least soon. Hey? He's still present in Wageningen. But of course, that collaboration will be continued. We have a few minutes left, and I think it's fair to maybe, Jo, if I can give you one small reaction maybe on what you have heard, that you can give that back to us. And then the last minutes, and I'm very sorry that we do not have a lot of time for discussions. I would like to give Ruurt some final time to give some reflections. I hope that's okay with you. Jo, can I give you the word?
Sure. I mean, there's a lot of things which have come true, both in the chat and what people have said. Well, let me just make maybe two points then. One is on the general issue. Okay, one word which I did not hear, but which is obviously extremely important, is just simple economic growth in general, right? And so if you see that the worsening of food security is clearly correlated strongly with a decline in economic growth in Africa, for example, and a number of other countries as well, I mean, that's something we should not leave out of our mind by focusing solely on the food system. So that, I think, is really important. Also for resilience, I mean, basically, if people have better income, better jobs, etc., they're more resilient to shocks to the system as well. On the other hand, there was a couple of points on which, what is this externality effect of subsidies, how does that play a role? I think there the issue is not so much giving subsidies or not, it's rather, again, the form, the nature of how you give subsidies. And for example, one of the results which seemed to come out is that decoupled subsidies, as most of the EU subsidies are now, are doing better also in terms of reducing externalities than coupled subsidies. Why don't I leave it at this?
Thank you very much, Jo, for this reflection. Once again, much more can be said on the topics and on the points. I do invite Krijn and Ruurt to maybe pick some points up in their speech later this week on Wednesday when you, let's say, give a keynote on that. Ruurt, can I give you the final word to give some reflections?
It is not easy to have a final word. What happens today is precisely what we meant when we organized this event, that you end up with more questions than answers. But that's okay, because that's the agenda for the future. Thanks to both Jo and Marijke for their very insightful presentations and also the comments from Maximo and Paul. It reflects a little bit my own career, because I started as a macroeconomist and ended up as a microeconomist. And I think many of us have made the same transition, and now we are at the stage that we should bring those two strings together if we want to be effective also for the policy debate. I have three remarks to make. First of all, I was very pleased to see that everywhere now food systems thinking is so much in the lead. When I came back to Wageningen 6 years ago, I was asked to lead a program on food security. And the basic question at that time was, can we produce sufficient food to feed the world? But now I think the questions are different. It is really how to link production and consumption, how to give in concrete recommendations for both public and private action. I think we have grown a lot, and I'm very pleased also that the UN summit is not called the Food Security Summit, but the Food System Summit. The second observation, of course, is both Jo and Maximo mentioned, let's say, when I started 40 years ago, my motivation was to work on poverty, hunger, and malnutrition. And to be honest, we are now, after COVID, almost 20 years back in time. So those are still very pressing issues. And in a certain way, that is worrisome, and it's also a little bit a shame, I feel. Now, is that due to insufficient insights from science? I don't think so, to be honest. I think we learned a lot in research and in policy-related activities on what are root causes and what we should do in order to overcome poverty and malnutrition. And let me just take up three aspects that were mentioned also in the presentation. First, still, access to resources is quite fundamental. My first work was on land reform in Nicaragua, and I still believe that many poor people, both urban and rural, are very limited in their access to resources, land and finance and others. And in addition to that, of course, now we talk more about how that can change behavior of people and make them, let's say, more risk accepting, etc. But access to resources and infrastructure, as Maximo said, remains to be very important. Secondly, let's say we need to change a lot of knowledge, both of farmers and of consumers and producers and in the market. But we have quite little information on how that works. And I was very pleased to see in Marijke's presentations that also in the Institute, more and more attention is going to how to change behavior at different levels. And then finally, of course, the inequality issue remains very strong on the table. It almost received no attention until the last 5-6 years. But the distribution of resources and the distribution of activities, urban and rural and male and female and poor and middle class, means that there is not an easy policy device that helps everybody. And you should be aware that that is also that the distribution of effects of policies are different. Now, let me just conclude with, and I can go on with that next Wednesday, but I do see that there are a few challenges now, new challenges on the table, which I would love to work on, but I'm sure that there are many young people that are capable of doing that. The resilience issue mentioned, after COVID, of course, we are all more aware that we should be able to say something on how recovery from shocks happens and how people deal with uncertainty. The second issue, I think, is about transitions themselves. That has not been mentioned too much, but I became very much aware that economics is not only about supply and demand, but particularly about governance, how the things are, how those are linked, what are the contracts between producers and consumers, etc., and the many policy dilemmas that are there. And then finally, I think we have to be forward looking in the type of solutions we pursue and we propose. And just to explain the example that Marijke mentioned, in my work in Nicaragua, we started at a certain moment a discotheque as part of a development program, because we wanted to capture the rents from the large landholders that after they slaughtered their animals, that we would get as a government control on those resources to get them reinvested. And everybody said that's consumptive investment. But to be honest, I think that was a very well done investment. And it also enabled me to learn a little bit dance, the Latin American dance. So that was a double benefit. Okay, next Wednesday, I will say more about this. But I was very pleased to see all those presentations and the challenges that they posed to us for the future research agenda. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Ruud. Then I'm going towards the closure because 2 o'clock has passed already. We had over 180 participants, so I think that's a nice number. A lot of people that were interested in this in these contributions. There are many more questions, indeed. We look forward to the keynote, Ruud, that you're going to give on Wednesday. Tomorrow we have the Food Systems in European Agricultural Policy webinar, and there Krijn will also, let's say, be reflecting upon what will be discussed. I would like to thank again the keynote speakers, Joswin and Marijke Kuiper. Thank you very much. And also Maximo and Paul for your discussant role. Sorry, Maximo, it was only 5 minutes. Next time we'll give you much more time, of course. Once again, we could have had much more discussions. We're going to have that this week, and we probably will meet again on other occasions. Thank you very much for the contribution, and hope to see you tomorrow again. Bye-bye.